we're on the road again, because we're heading to Helmond, to the Home Computer Museum.
Yep.
Bart, who is the owner of the Home Computer Museum, he contacted me and he said, Eric, I'm going to clear off some excess stock, meaning he has some vintage computers for sale. So I'm all about that. So I said, okay, I'm going to check it out. So yeah, let's see him. So that was nice. It was a lot of stuff there. Often stuff was in not that great shape, but everything that was nice and presentable, we were able to buy a lot of stuff out of it. Of course, some other vendors were there as well. It was quite busy. We couldn't really film there because there were a lot of people, but we were able to buy some very nice computers. So we've got some stuff in the back, and I think here in front you can already see that I was able to buy a couple of Kypros. So I will show you the rest of the stuff that we bought now. Yeah, that was fun.
Watch out for Sinclair.
Behind me are the computers that I was able to buy at the Home Computer Museum. I didn't even count them, but I'm sure that almost everything is from the 80s. There's one bit more modern, and I'm sure you can spot it. And if you can't spot it, I will show you in a minute. And I will explain also why I bought it. So let's go over all these computers, shall we? So the first computer I want to go inside is this one. The TRS-80 Model 3. It's a very well-known computer from 1980. And it was, jump ahead, it was already discontinued in 1983. Very well known, as I said, and it features a Zilog Z80 processor at 2 MHz. And it only had 4 kilobytes of RAM, but it was expandable to 48. And here is a button that says 48K RAM, so this one was expanded apparently. The display is 16 rows of 64 characters, and it could also do block graphics. If you wanted sound, you have to get that through the cassette output. Normally when it boots up, it wants floppy in one of those floppy drives, and it wants to boot TRS DOS from disks. But there was a built-in basic interpreter as well. More often than not, people converted it to run CPM, which was a more popular operating system in the 80s, of course. This all-in-one package made it very easy for the educational market. One of the things that made it interesting for the educational market is that no students could go off and steal some of the components. So, TRS 80 Model 3. Next, as you can see, I bought two of these P2000Ts. So, let's take those. The P2000T by Philips is Philips' first home computer. It was introduced in 1980, more marketed back in 1981, and it has a built-in basic interpreter. It has 16 kilobytes of memory, and it was expandable to 48 kilobytes. Philips recognizably used components from other stuff that they made. They made all kinds of home electronics equipment, and they still do up to a certain point. And they used from their dictation machines the mini cassette drive. And the mini cassette drive could hold here up to 42 kilobytes of data. There were two cartridge slots, which by the way were also used earlier in the Odyssey or G7000, so the video pack system. What I can't show you now is what they also used, and which is very typical for the machine, is the teletext graphics that they used in televisions. So the teletext software and hardware that they used for televisions was used as a display driver, a display system for this home computer. The P2000T was very popular in both the educational markets, but also in the communication markets for users like Viditel. It was discontinued back in 1984 when Philips started producing MSX home computers. At the same time of the P2000T, there was also a similar computer which had the same motherboard called the P2000M. So also a Z80 based computer, but it was similar to the TRS-80 Model 3. It had a screen and 5.25-inch floppy drives, and it could run CPM. A portable version of the P2000M was created in 1982. I have one here, so let's exchange this. There it is. So it tries to boot from both floppy drives, of course, but since I don't have any disks here, I will leave it at that for now. But let me tell you something about the P2000C. As I said, you had the P2000M, which was a CPM capable system based on the P2000T, introduced at the same time as the P2000T. So while the P2000T was completely targeted, I guess, for the home and the educational market, P2000M was the machine to have when you ran a business. And, well, this was the portable machine, as it says. It's not a laptop computer. I will get to that next, because I will show you one of the very first officially laptop computers. In 1981, Epson introduced what is arguably the first true laptop computer. And it has two proprietary 8-bit processors, 16 kilobytes of RAM, and it holds in its ROM a basic interpreter, the Epson basic interpreter. And here it is. The Epson HX20. As I said, it was introduced in 1981. It's a very nice keyboard, by the way. And it holds this LCD screen, which is 120x32 dot matrix. And standard mini cassette drive. This one looks a bit rough, to be honest. And built-in printer, and the printer could print 24 columns also in matrix. computer. Let me show you how small it actually is. So this has some connectors here. Power on off. Microphone. Hier. Barcode scanner connector. Power adapter, and then two serial ports. One is labeled RS232C, which is actually 110 to 4800 bits per second serial connector. The other one is labeled serial, which is also RS232C, but then at 38.4 kilobits per second. Then there is an expansion slot at the other end. And you could buy, for example, a floppy drive to connect to this. So let's pop that back in. Let's jump to 1983, when a small firm called Kypro decided they should remake their very popular business computer, which is also a portable. Let me take out the Kypro Model 10 and tell you why it's a very important machine in computer history. So this is the Kypro 10. And why did they name it Kypro 10? I will tell you in a second. First, let's have a look at the back. Here is the power. This is a printer port. Some serial ports, I guess. Cable for the keyboard. Another small cable there. I don't know what for. And let's see if we can pop it open. Ta-da! Somebody put a label on here called Safety First. And here is a hint why it says it is called the Kypro 10. You can see already 10MB ready. This is a big deal. Kypro introduced this machine back in 1983. It features not only a Z80 processor at 2.5 MHz, which makes it perfect for running CPM, 64 kilobytes of RAM. You have this floppy drive, which is a single-sided drive and can hold 191 kilobytes. But this was one of the very first home computers, very first computers that had built-in hard drive. 10 megabytes of hard disk. And that is the reason why I think it's called Kypro 10. So it's the very one of the earliest computers to do so, to have a built-in hard disk. So normally used to run CPM, and with this 9-inch monochrom display, a green monochrom display, you could show up to 80 columns. And it really competed with the Osborne 1 at that time, which had a very small, much smaller, 5-inch screen. So the Kypro 10, I'm not going to turn it on here because I want to open it up and clean it before I try to turn it on. Next, you have already seen it in the pile, a very similar computer, also by Kypro. So this is the Kypro 16. It looks very similar to the Kypro 10, which we just saw. And it is by itself a very different machine though. The Kypro 16 was introduced in 1985. So as I said, very similar to the Kypro 10 in the way that it's built. But as you can see, it doesn't have a built-in hard drive. It has two floppy drives instead. But the biggest important difference between a Kypro 10 and a Kypro 16 is the Kypro 16 has not the Z80 processor, but an 8088 processor by Intel, which makes it compatible. And indeed, that is what it's used for running MS-DOS. For the rest, for all looks and feels, it looks very similar to the Kypro 10. A bit more updated keyboard, a bit different connector also, but equally a luggable computer. So let's close her up and let's have a look at something much smaller and introduced 1 year earlier than this. This computer from Sinclair Corporation in the UK is introduced. It was introduced back in 1984. Sinclair, you know it from the wildly popular ZX Spectrum, and this was its successor. What you might not expect is that this actually runs on a 68000 processor. So let's take it out of its package. Most of the weight of this packaging is actually taken up by the wild big manual. Put that aside for now. And here it is. The Sinclair QL. So from 1984, successor to the ZX Spectrum, as I said. And the QL stands for Quantum Leap. The internal codename, by the way, was ZX83. But it surely was a quantum leap. It came with Office software. There was a word processor called Quill. There was a spreadsheet called Abacus. There was a paint program called Easel. And database software called Archive. It also has a built-in basic interpreter called Super Basic. The storage was kind of interesting. So as you can see, you see two tape heads here, because the storage was done on what they call infinite loop tape cartridges. There was like 5 meters of tape in these cartridges, and they hold up to 100 kilobyte per cartridge. It was not a huge success, and it was discontinued back in 1986. Next, the Commodore Amiga 500. I think a lot of you already know this one. It's not a very rare computer, but I'm happy to have it in the box and with its display. So let's unpack this. They didn't do a great packing job, but seems most of it is here. Dust cover with a lot of dust. A mouse, Commodore brand. Power brick. And the computer itself. So this system definitely needs some love and cleaning, and I will take care of that. But first, so this is the low-end Amiga 500 with a 68000 processor, similar to the Sinclair QL that you just saw. And the case was similar to the Commodore 128 actually. So the low-cost Amiga, well, the low-entry Amiga, It was introduced in 1987 to compete more with the Atari ST. And it became an instant success, usually adopted by the people at home using it mostly for games. And it was discontinued in 1992 when it was replaced by the Amiga 600 and even more popular, the Amiga 1200. So, yeah, what can I say about an Amiga that you don't already know? But there's one more thing. I promised you one thing from the 90s. And this is it. This is a Sunray 150. This is from 1999 and this is created by Sun Microsystems, of course, which was later bought by Oracle. But before that they created the whole range of Sunray, including this one based in on a 15-inch screen, and that's why it's called the Sunray 150. So, except for the 15-inch display, it is a thin client, and it's based on a MicroSpark processor, and therefore there is a lot of goodies on the side and on the back. So there's this weird purple side which features a smart card reader as well as the buttons for the, and here you can see the power adapter, which I have to find. Then there is this VGA connector, I guess, video connector, 4 USB ports and Ethernet port, which is of course needed if you want to run it on a network. So here are the audio connectors. So I wanted to end it with this one. It's my Jurassic Spark. So, with the exception of the last thin client from 1999, I gave you a quick run-through of the 80s computers that I happened to be able to buy at the Home Computer Museum. So, thank you very much to Bart, who tipped me and said, hey, I have some excess stock. Thanks also to Sabine and Edwin for hauling it out of the museum and carrying a lot of stuff for me. What am I going to do? I'm going to clean this up, test them a bit further, make sure that they're presentable and in very nice condition. And yeah, I am going to resell them. So I have a shop in Eindhoven in the Netherlands where I sell vintage technology, but also retro gaming and other stuff. Toys from the 70s and 80s, etc. So all kinds of collectibles and great childhood memories, I often call them. So if you stop by Eindhoven, then drop by and come and see me. All info is, of course, on my website. So for now, I want to thank you very much for watching. I hope you liked this video. I hope you enjoyed seeing these nice computers from the 80s. And if you did, give a thumbs up. Make sure to subscribe, as we're going to hunt throughout Europe for collectibles, including vintage tech. And for now, I want to thank you very much for watching. Stay safe. Bye.